is a story all about how my life got flipped, turned upside down. And I'd like to take a minute, just sit right there. I'll tell you how I became the prince of a town called Bel Air.
All right, welcome back to the Cycling Collab podcast, the off the record, off the cuff, and sometimes off topic. Look at all things cycling from at home and around the world. I'm Angus Petrie, and joining me, as always, is our leader of GC, Reon Nolan. Now, Reon, you can take GC to mean whatever you like.
Word. Bro, fizzing, Tour of Southland, SBS Tour of Southland, ripping it.
Yep. SBS Tour of Southland special here on the Cycling Collab podcast. And you have been, like you say, fizzing for days for this.
Bro, months. I'm so shattered that I'm not racing it, but who cares? Hey, I'm fit. And you like call-ups? I'm good.
Did you hear that? Late call-ups. Here we go. This will be out like 2 days before the race. And he's still willing to go. He's been training his butt off. Yeah. He's good to go.
Ripping. Bro, good to be here, bro. I'm pretty stoked about this, especially about the history, about Southland, all the other little bit of news coming up, but
It's good. And what I want to say first is actually thank you to everybody who has watched the Cycling Collab podcast on YouTube, that have given us a subscribe, a like. All of that helps us do more and share more. And of course, also, if you've listened to us over on Apple Podcasts or Spotify, there seems to be plenty of people that would rather listen to us than look at our faces, bro.
Mate, your face. I'm the hot one here. that's pretty cool, though.
It's really cool.
I like that. You just think, I do this for fun because I love it. You rock me into it. But then you see like people viewing, and then you see people downloading. It's like, oh, that's actually pretty cool. And the feedback I've had, like out on Bunch Rides and stuff, people saying, oh, pretty amazing. I listen to it on Spotify and stuff. I was like, oh, it's actually pretty cool, eh?
It is pretty cool. Yeah, it is. And it's only going to get better. So don't stop listening. Don't stop watching, because there's some cool shit to come.
Yeah, boy.
Well, News of the World wouldn't be a podcast without starting with the News of the World. And we've actually been 3 weeks or something now, and we have had a few people calling, when is the next one? Well, we're here now, but there's been plenty of news, so we'll just do a quick summary of some highlights that we've picked out, eh?
Yeah, man. Do you want me to start? Or you
can start.
Go. Okay, sick. So remember we were talking about, I think at Paris-Roubaix, and Henrietta Christie, was it Will Champs?
We were. No, yeah. Paris-Roubaix.
Yeah, yeah. So she, I'm pretty sure Henrietta Christie had done that, right? But also in another race, she was out the front attacking. It might have been Champs, bro. Oh, I can't remember. But anyway, young girl.
She's a hitter, is what we're saying.
Yeah, weapon attacking. But so she signed to Rally Cycling, the American team.
Yep.
Which is pretty badass. And then the other young girl, female hitter, weapon sprinter killer, has signed a 2-year deal they just announced, and she's a New Zealand crit champion. So she's got a bit of gas, real mean in the track as well, bro. And her brother's he's a pretty bit of a good rider as well.
So great to see Henrietta and Olivia signing with a pro women's team, and also again the big ups to Rally Cycling, who are really taking some riders on board. And we were discussing off here that actually really what we'd like to see is every men's pro tour team should really be fielding a women's team.
Yeah, it's pretty close, I think.
It's getting there. It is getting there.
Yeah, obviously it's about money. And so Trek actually matched the prize money of all the men for the rest of the year for the females team, and they get, and a few other teams like that as well, which is pretty cool, eh? But, I mean, it's all money and sponsorship, eh? How do you do that?
It is.
100%, what was it?
A few other signings, Jack?
Sorry. Going back to Ray, Olivia Ray. And the cool thing about body image, she put this this interview out, and she speaks pretty highly about it, about how in cycling you've got to be ripped lean to get up the hills and all these types of things, and a lot of food issues start from it, a lot comes from that, from a lot of pro riders, men, women, whoever you are. But she's come out saying in a wicked article actually, but she's like, she's proud of who she is, and she's like I don't want to use wrong words, but like a bigger, stronger girl, quite muscular, sprinting, powerful, and she's actually happy with who she is and what her body type is, and that she races for that, not trying to change your body type to try and be a 30 kg climber and just ruin your life and body image and eating habits and da da. So it's real cool that this stuff's kind of coming out.
Yeah, it's great to see or hear and see her speak up about that, because it's a massive problem.
Yeah bro, hard, no shit.
Look at you. You need another pot.
Bro, mate, I'm overweight. Straight into that. I see my issues. I used to be 75 kg, mate. I could go up hills averagely.
You grew old. That was your problem, Reon. You grew old.
I'm 40. I'll take that.
What else is happening there? Aaron Gate. In Now, of course, my French or my actual anything other than New Zealand English is pretty rubbish. So, Le Chrono des Nations in France, he was fourth in the individual time trial, beating none other than Remco Evenepoel, and was sort of 50k per h, 50k an hour for 44.5 k's.
Far out.
Right, that's in the Le Chrono des Nations. That is a 1 day time trial, individual time trial specialist event.
Yeah, gnarly, bro. Did you see the photo of him though, bro? He looks so mean. Like the black and white skin suit, black TT booties with the silver fern on it. Oh,
well,
gangster.
Well, I always do like to say, you know, if all else fails, look good doing it.
Yeah. Hey, didn't he just win? He just won silver, where was it? World Champs?
In the Omnium? In the Omnium. Yeah. So for those out there that don't know what an Omnium is, are you going to... You don't know what an Omnium is? Okay,
it's,
so...
It's heaps of events put in one.
So it's four.
Four, yeah.
It was six, and then in 2016, they changed it to four.
Yeah.
There's a scratch race, a tempo race, an elimination race, and a points race. And he scored second in that, so that's showing multi-disciplines.
Has he won that before or not? Surely. I'm pretty sure he has. That's my guess. I don't know. He's a fucking weapon. But hey, bro, have you ever ridden on the track?
Never.
Mate, don't start. Nah. If I had a kid or, you know, like young people, I'd say get to the track. Mate, you can learn so much on the track. Like, just in terms of bike handling, braking, awareness, people around you, just a lot from it, and also a lot of explosive power.
Yeah.
Pretty good place to start. Go to BMXing first.
We do see a lot of pros coming and going track, switching across all the time, right?
Yeah. Oh, bro, just a touch on it. I actually was going through some Tour of Southland banter, and there was some stuff popping off on the social media I won't get into, about Aaron Gate, Vink, and a few others about last year or whatever. I don't know.
The boys were throwing a few stones inside the glass house.
I mean, it was all in good faith, but there was some stuff that got made of light. But hey, oh, bro, you skip one. Let's just ditch that for a minute. Jack Drake. He signed to, how do you say it? Hagos Berman Axion. Is that right?
I don't know, but that's how I take it. Yeah. Hagen Berman Axion.
Yeah. Yeah.
Now, this team has some incredible history to it. So if you sign here, you're on your way.
Yeah. Well, I won't say that because you never know. Because a lot, you know, but fuck, it's a golden ticket. If you're like focused, determined, listen and play right, good team support. So the guy who runs the team, Axel Merckx. You know who his fucking father is.
I know who Eddie is.
Also, Eddie Merckx. Bro, you walk into people's houses and they've got photos framed up from the 90s, whatever, the best, you know, the boss of cycling, and his son runs the team. So you imagine this, bro. Imagine how much push that guy's got, the son and the father. Hey, Eddie, Dad. Oh, hold on, the phone rings. Hey, Dad, I've got this rider that can hold whatever, just, you know, like, so, and then if we go over, okay, bro, so the Kiwi riders that have ridden for that team, obviously I know some of them and know of the rest, but so George Bennett.
Yep.
Look at him, what he's done and where he is now.
They've got some rubbish podcast, I hear.
Oh, yeah. Fuck, they're actually pretty good. I mean, they've got credibility behind them, bro. So you look at Bennett, and look, so he's been a part of that team, right? You got Michael Vink, like, speaks for itself.
I've heard of that guy. I know that guy?
Wait, two times Tour of Southland winner, right? Yeah, two. And then he nearly won last year by 1 second, lost it by Aaron Gate. Okay, James Roram has been a part of that team. Now he's on part of Black Spoke, race around the world. Bro, here we go, Southland special. Josh Atkins was on that team. So you might not know Josh Atkins, but, mate, I remember doing Tuesday Worlds, going up Gibby's Pass as hard as I could. And, bro, I was okay rider, just okay.
Just okay.
He comes past me, bro, in the big ring like I was...
In the gutter.
Yeah, I was in the gutter, bro, dropped. Like incredible. And so he signed for that team as well. So my point being that a lot of Kiwis have taken a part of that team, but also like Taylor Penny, Alex Dowsett, like I could go on, Joe Dombrowski, like there's a lot of riders that have been part of that racing development squad, whatever, and have gone World Tour, Pro Tour, and kicked some ass. So it's a good step for him. And yeah, it's just a good step for him.
And a great little segue there quickly, just going to change this because I didn't put it on our notes page You mentioned Alex Dowsett and he's going for the hour record on November 3rd in Mexico.
Yeah.
So that'll be interesting to see whether, because of course he used to hold the record until...
Did Bradley Wiggetts take it off?
Yeah, Bradley Wiggetts took off. I'm like, they didn't hold it for very long before Bradley came along. So it'll be good to see if Alex can get up again. And
Don't know Alex, but I don't think he's going to get it. He did the national TT Champions DNF.
He did.
But that could have been a flat, sick, not going good. I mean, obviously he's a Pro Tour hitter, boss. I actually watch his movie on YouTube. I'm a bit of a fan, actually. I think he would beat Bradley Wiggins' time. I don't know about the big one, but we'll see. I hope he does.
Yeah.
His skin suit's worth like $4,000. Chain ring's worth £900. All this type of shit. Like, he's going full gas for it. Yeah. So pretty cool to watch.
If you watched his one of his latest YouTube vlogs, and we really are digressing, but if you watch one of those and the Thighs Club, there's a big shout out for Alex. The Thighs Club is what his YouTube channel is called. Yeah. And they received a phone call and they lost a sponsor, and that left them 30 grand short of putting it together.
Yeah.
So that was 30 grand short. They already had sponsors and some stuff paid. So how much is this project costing them?
Nah, and bro, here's the thing. He was saying on there, he's like when he was with Movistar, they did everything. He didn't have to lift a finger, you know, and now he's having to organize everything himself. Cool thing about that dude is, has he got necrophilia?
No. Hemophilia.
But he's got a little charity called Little Bleeders. So money goes that he raises, like sponsoring him shoes. It's actually pretty cool. Like to show you've got not a disability, but something that you're struggling with, but you can still make it in the world. Anyway, good luck, bro. Rip it. Just saying. What else, bro?
Well, you wanted to talk about the Italian team at Track Worlds, their Pinarello's exited stage left.
Yeah, right. So, okay, hold on. So those bikes were like 30,000 euros each. So, like crazy with the frame, paint, the wheels, the chain rings, power meters, those new TT bars that are like all made for each individual rider. So they've just won all the stuff there, right? Kicked ass again, right? The fact of the bikes are... And then someone or some people, or is it the mafia?
Oh,
no joke, bro. I reckon it's corruption. But anyway, someone's nicked all their bikes, gone. How are you going to ride those gold Pinarello? I'm like,
well, it'll be an inside job, but I'm quite excited to see what you turn up on, Reon, to your attempt in some coming months, and whether you've got a new Pinarello. Yeah.
Bro, do you know, going back to my attempt, Rolly's going to help me with that, but... So I've got a track bike, I've got a rear disc, front five-spoke, tri-spoke, or five-spoke and a tri-spoke, and some other stuff coming. So yeah, that's on it.
So if you're listening to this podcast as your first one, if you didn't hear hear episode one, what we're talking about here is we have roped Reon into having a couple of cracks at an hour record.
Yeah.
We're going to go outdoors first and do Denton Park.
Denton Park.
And just run an hour record at an outdoor one, and then actually quietly, there is no current New Zealand outdoor record. So if you want one, you need to get in quick. And then in some time to come, we're going to go indoors and do a comparison from outdoor to indoor. So that's what the old bloke here is on about. He's going to ride round and round and round for an hour, and I'm going to drink beer.
Bro, here's the good news for me, right? I checked every day. There's no New Zealand M2 on Masters 2, by the way, humans. There's no national record. There's M1, there's M3, and everything else in an elite. So whatever, I could do one lap, and I'm gonna break a New Zealand record. So fuck you, I'm gonna do this shit.
Well, maybe not, because now you're just throwing down the challenge for everybody else to quickly jump out there, quickly throw one on the board, and be the first to do it.
Edit this shit.
Yeah.
I'm gonna put you in the gutter.
So that's that. Pinarello bike stolen. Yeah, one from me, American Ashton Lambie. He wins gold in the individual pursuit at the Track World Cycling. Why have I picked him out? Because that guy rocks a cool mustache.
Yeah, and he must have the amazing, like, 5-minute power, right? In a TT position.
In a TT position.
Fuck. Do they are standing start, right? Yeah. Beep, 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 and they fucking rip out. Standing start, big chain ring, whatever it is, big gear.
Big muscle.
And, wicked, eh? Imagine his watts. Fuck me.
I've got some of them. About three.
3 watts. What else you got?
Tade Pekedja, Podjakar, however you say that again.
Today.
Podjakar. If you're listening, I apologize for your.
He's listening right now, mate. He doesn't give a fuck about us.
Rumor on the mill is that Ineos offered him $18 million over 3 years, $6 million a year, and he's turned it down.
Yeah, bro, they're trying to poach him. Yeah. He signed a contract with UAE. He's got the main deal there, and he's won, da-da-da. And, bro, it's so interesting because now, so who is Ineos now? They've been getting their ass kicked, right? You know, I mean, all respect to them and their team and the funders.
Money and everything.
They're getting smoked, and then they're like, what do we do here?
We pour more money in.
Yeah, which is, that's the game, and it's a big hustle. But and he said no, eh? Did he say no?
Yeah.
Work it. But imagine that, getting $18 million. Damn, son.
Ride your bicycle.
Ooh, that's pretty gangster.
I mean, there's a bit more that goes on than just riding your bicycle, isn't there?
Yeah.
One that really stood out is from local here in Christchurch.
Yeah.
Matthew Fairbrother, 17 years old, and has just completed 24 hours on his mountain bike, doing 10,119 vertical meters in that 24 hours. He's 17 years old. riding laps of our local Vic Park here, the Worm, Break Free, Sesame Street, Shazza's, Pono's, lap after lap after lap. And they have written a really cool article. So if you get over onto pinkbike.com and have a look, there's an article up there that they've written based on that. But
well, I know him. He's a good dude.
And this isn't his first cool thing that he did, because at 15, he did his first Everest, and that was on a mountain bike too.
That's nuts, eh? And you know where he'd done that? I think he made a mistake there, because he'd done that up Sumner and all the way up to Mount Pleasant. So it was longer, big turn, slow descent. Yeah. So he might have did over 300 kilometers.
Well, I had a funny feeling he'd done a gravel, like a proper off-road one, though.
No, you've been drinking. Not sure what you're talking about. But anyway, bro, he obviously, he's that's crazy, right? The mental strength there is like, it's pretty amazing to do that.
Well, because the first bit of the womb, each lap, so he's 24 hours in or he's 12 hours in, doesn't really matter.
Yeah.
The first piece of that lap is a gap jump.
Yeah, that's what I mean. So that was my point, bro. Do you know, I was in Vic Park with him. I was just following, like just walking my bike down all the harbors. Bro, he jumps over like streets. That's how good he is. Like, and just big whips in the air. So he's not only mentally strong, he's actually very like physically capable of like ripping shit up. So yeah, wicked, eh? See where he goes. Someone needs to sign him. He rides a S-Work Specialized.
He does. Just saying. Just saying. Yeah. That's not a trick, though.
Nah, it's wrong bike, mate. Get a trick. Yeah, mate.
Righto. Well, that is news of the world for today's podcast, which only leads us to one thing, and that's what we all came for. It's what you're here for, and is the Tour of Southland, the SBS Tour of Southland 2021 edition. So I suppose what we should do really is we should start right from the start, bro. And maybe because you are the man with the history. Let's wind the clock back. And I think the year is 1956, which is the first year of the Tour of Southland.
So hold on. Let's really start.
What is the Tour of Southland?
In my opinion, Tour of Southland is the hardest stage race in New Zealand by far. It's got the... is so well respected. So when I first started cycling and when I got out of prison and rehab, no joke, I started riding at 26, and all I heard about was Tour of Southland, and I was like, oh, I never could do that, you know, never thought I could be a part of it. And it's just like, mate, you win something down there, you know, it's like you got a bit of mana around New Zealand, and this is my opinion, you know, like if you can win
and
a stage
minis,
zero,
I would say.
Yeah, like, you know, it just shows you can win there, you can win anywhere, and like that's my opinion, you know what I mean? You look at the people who've won it, and they're obviously weapons or even stage winners. They're capable of going overseas and doing some stuff, or, you know, top five, even top 10 on GC are actually capable bike riders. Mate, even to finish a Tour of Southland, bro, mate, most people in the world could not do it, because it's that physically fucking hard and demanding. The crosswinds, the rain, the team tactics, you know, like, bro, it's out the gate. So in my opinion, bro, it's the most gangster race in New Zealand and something to be proud of for New Zealand.
It's a proper bike race, right?
Yeah, 100%. And like the really cool thing about it is like it's from the deep south, and the people of Invercargill get behind it. Like all the business, there's one team on there that Alan Dunn runs, I think, small business south. That's heaps of businesses that all put money into,
which is cool.
Yeah, and all the other composite teams are businesses from there down there as well, you know, to like support five riders, whatever it is. It's pretty amazing, bro. Like it's shit is what it is.
It is and it's filled with history. Some great New Zealand riders, and multi-time winners too. We've had likes of Brian Fowler, who's got the most wins, six wins down there, seven wins total.
So like, well, actually says here, it says 8 wins total. He won 6 in a row, then Stu Lowe won, and then he won, Brian Fowler went to win the next one. The first winner though, this will be the 65th year it's running, I'm pretty sure. This is an interesting thing. Eh? It was in the UCI tour. However, that stopped. So a few years it was UCI, you get UCI points, but now it stopped. It's just like a no UCI points type of thing. The first winner is a guy, Calvin Hastel.
Hasty?
From
Dunedin?
Yep. Yeah. So 1956. So that's the first ever winner.
And Pat Wiley was the first ever King of the Mountain.
There we go, mate. There we go. And you're like, so Vinks won it twice in a row. Rowley's won 3 in a row. Then it got stopped by, who was that by? Yeah, Hayden Rolson. So 2006, 2007, 2008, Hayden Rolson. Then Heath Blackgrove, 2009. Then 2010, back to Rowley. Hold on, this is a key one. The young guy that was on Jack Drake's team, the Argos Axion, Josh Atkins, youngest ever winner of Tour of Southland.
At 19.
Yeah, 19. I bet she goes top on the wall, just saying. Fuck, that's my claim to fame. Then Mike Norley, James Oram, Mitchell Lovelock Flay, Brad Evans. Brad Evans, which Aaron Gate, James Piccoli, you know, signed pro tour after that race as well. Michael Vink, Aaron Gate. So, I mean, bro, let's hit a material, eh?
Very
wicked.
And not only that, but we've had Tour of Southland. You think it's a little New Zealand race down here in the middle of nowhere, but it's had some pretty big international pro riders here, right?
Yeah. Oh, like who's the guy that won the tour? Tour de France, Floyd Landers, bro. Floyd Landers done tour. I'm pretty sure someone told me Levi Limeheimer. Is that his name? The little climber of Lance Summit. So he's done it. Hold on, bro. My first tour of Southland when I was like an average B grader, suffering every day in the Gruppetto, riding by myself, just making it. I got the Lanton Rouge, no shit. Hardest thing I've ever done in my life, but the most beautiful thing. I was trying to get in the breakaway on one of these stages, right? And I was like, why the won't they let me go? I'm nobody. I'm shit. You know, I'd probably get in the break and get dropped from it. But the guy I was trying to get away with, I get back to the peloton, and one of the, like, I'd call him the elder statesman, the guy, Roman Van Uden, who's like a weapon, you know, like stage winner, raced overseas. You know, you look at him like a gold when you first start. He comes up to me, he's like, in the peloton, when I'm fucked, he's like, bro, don't try and get away with that guy. And I was like, I didn't understand what he said. I was like, oh, what do you mean, bro? I thought he was getting smart to me. He's like, bro, look at his bike. To give me a clue, I looked at him. He's got a BMC bike, BMC helmet, BMC gloves, aero socks, all this type of. And I was like, oh, he's like, yeah, bro. He's basically he's like a world tour signing to the junior team. And it was Stephen Kong. There's been like countless others, very strong Aussie riders. There's been fucking, you know, UK riders, UK teams, Aussie teams coming all over. Like the who's who of that and that have been part of this race, and it's pretty well respected. Simon Polong, who turned up, he was on IM cycling team, it's now Folder, but World Tour team.
Yeah.
He done it on training wheels. And I was like, looking at this guy's shorts, and I just thought he was a punter wearing Tour of Southland or everything else. But he had these IM, it was World Tour team, the shorts on. I was like, he's quite ripped. He looks like a shit kicker. Mate, he's in the break three times. He's doing the Tour of Southland on training wheels, and he's like last to get caught up Coronet Peak. And he's just signed to, bro, he got the most aggressive rider in the latest edition of the Tour de France. And now he's just signed a Trek this year, just signed a contract. So he's done it.
We can claim it. Can we say that he started, he got his big break at the Tour of Southland in little old New Zealand?
Yeah. So
I think we can.
Bro, it's fucking epic. Hey. Like, it's badass, man. It's so hard. It's a hard tour. Can we just go back to a bit of history about Southland?
Sure.
I think we're forgetting that something. So
we are.
Can you see this trophy here, this cup here?
So this is sitting on our podcast podium.
Yeah, boy.
We had a cobble
from the
Paris-Roubaix. Yeah. Previous episode, we had a cobble from the Paris-Roubaix.
Yeah.
Now we've got this classy bit of hat, I must say. This is a pretty classy hat.
I got that off the race director, Bruce Ross. He's now stopped. The Ross family are amazing, actually.
But let's talk about the trophy. Let's talk
about
it. You
read it out, mate.
So this is the Ivan West Memorial Cup.
Westie.
And he died in 1994 or something. Is that right?
Yeah, he died just before the 1994 Tour of Southland.
And so then this cup was then obviously put up in his honour.
Yeah.
And normally a 100K stage from Mossburn to Winton or something, I believe, right?
Yep. Finished outside. Bro, this is another good story. So, you know, in Winton, I don't know if you've been there.
I've been to Winton.
So they've got a middle pub, end pub, and a top pub or something. So there's three pubs at the start of the town, the middle of the town, and the fucking end of the town. Yeah. It's crazy. So,
and that's about how it works in Winton, I tell you.
Yeah. And so this guy, so Westie owned that pub then. And he died away. He passed away. So they made this cup, and then the stage finished outside, which Stu Lowe won, and he won this cup here. There's a photo up there on the wall as well.
So just up here on the wall, I'll just have to point up here and across here somewhere. Look at that. Is a picture of Stu Lowe winning the stage there. But keep an eye on our social media on Instagram, Facebook, because I'll be putting a photo of that up at some stage.
And the guy in the photo there, Stu Lowe's winning stage, and he won the cup, obviously. But the guy who got second there, his name is Doug Bath, and he actually went on to win the tour because on the Blackmount stage, they put 5 minutes into Brian Fowler on the Blackmount stage. And I got some juicy stories about Blackmount. I love that stage. It used to be a Wednesday. They changed it. Fuck it. So
what difference does the day make?
No, because GC can be settled after day one and day two.
Okay, I see what you're saying.
Now they moved
it
forward.
Placement, not specifically the day, but the placement within the race.
Yeah, gotcha. 100%. So just going back to a little bit of history, I might be waffling here. This is about Stuart. I asked Stuart Lowe some questions, actually. And actually, the yellow jersey in the middle here that you can see, that's the Rothmans tour leader. That's Stuart Lowe's yellow jersey from winning the Tour of Southland. So that's a bit of gangster history there for the Tour of Southland, you know.
Stu won't have much left in his house by the time we're finished doing podcasts and taking things from
his
place.
Isn't he homeless? Stu's in a tent these days. Joking. He's a weapon. Actually, Brad Evans works for him, another Tour of Southland. Oh. Yeah, actually, story about Brad, legend. So this is what I asked Stu Lowe some questions, and he gave us a bit of insight about what Southland used to be like. He said, when I first started racing the Tour of Southland in 1987, I wasn't even born, I was six, we used to have 4 days, 3 days had three stages. 1 day had two stages. The first day, it was 70K of rolling hard hills. Another 70K in the afternoon was finished up Bluff Hill. And then they had a 20-kilometer crit around Bluff Town, finishing at 5 p.m. at night. That's a hard day, mate, you know? Stu says, I won the Tour in 1991 after a season racing in France, working on getting in breakaways. The podium that year was, so Stu Lowe won, Darren Rush second, and Graham Miller got third, who won the Commonwealth Games the year before. So when Stu Lowe won, this is pretty full on it. He broke Brian Feller's domination in the 80s. He won six in a row, and that's when Stu won his one, and then Brian Feller won the next one. Stu, he done 17 tours. He pretty much did Tour of Southland as a second home, you know. So, and that's like bread and butter, Tour of Southland Day. It's like riders' second home. They get to know the managers, the town owners, the sponsorship. It's such an amazing place. So I just thought it was quite special to grab first an old school Tour of Southland leaders jersey. And also we had Westies Cup there as well. You know, it's pretty emotional for Southland and the family and people all involved. Pretty cool, bro.
Very cool bit of history there. And a big thanks to Stu again for sharing his stuff. And of course, we will talk about them as we go along quickly as to what they are and who may be. But also just hanging on the wall over here, we must make mention too that we've got every winner's jersey or every stage. We've got we've got the sprint, we've got the KOM, most combative,
and so these are like, so we've got Hayden Rolston's yellow jersey, he's got his race numbers on it, PowerNet Tour of Southland, which is, I think, is cool, got his race numbers on there. Stu Lowe's old school Rothmans Tour of Southland. We've got Michael Vink's, he rode for Placemakers, that was his first Tour of Southland that he won, which is pretty special. We've got his jersey. We've got the Stonewood Homes silver jersey, which is called a Masters Racing. So if you're over the age of 35, I think it is, there's a small competition there, but fucking hotly contested for the old boys, eh? Yeah, like real good. And we've got the KOM jersey, which was Ollie's, Ollie Jones. And we've got the Sprint jersey, which is Ollie Jones as well. And actually, I won that. Hey. I won it twice, actually, for most. So they've changed that jersey. That used to be the jersey most competitive.
Did you put somebody in the gutter for that?
Oh, nah, they let me go. It was useless. But the thing is, bro, is that jersey there is my favorite one because that explains the type of rider I wanted to be. Like, that jersey is kind of like for the guy that didn't win a stage, didn't win anything, but he fucking damn near gave his heart out and was in all the breakaways or trying to get away and racing real aggressively on each stage. So every stage, they award the most aggressive rider. So a rider could have been away and got caught 5K to go or attacking the breakaway and, you know, just coming up short or just showed fucking a racing ability. And then you get that. And then overall, the tour, whoever got the most points, you win the jersey at the end. And mate, fuck, I was pretty grateful. I was nearly crying when I won that. For me, it's pretty epic, eh? And then, behind you, bro.
And if I just switch camera here, I may actually be able to just move out of the way so you can talk about those.
They're just a couple of tour leader jerseys from Vink's days as well. Vink's won two as well. Nearly won a third
just
for a couple of seconds.
Just a couple of just tour couple. Leader jerseys from Vink. Yeah. That's just
pretty cool, eh? Really. It's good. It's
like handy towels or anything.
Yeah, it's actually pretty
cool
just to have like a bit of memorabilia. Bro, those PowerNet shorts there, when you first done the Tour of Southland on a composite team, you had to wear those shorts. And like old school riders will know, they're the green PowerNet shorts. And I was so stoked to get them. I wore them for 3 days, mate. Couldn't walk. And they are the worst shorts back in the days to ever get. But I've still got them. And I actually love them. I'm probably going to wear them next week. And bro, I've got my every van a sign written up with your name on it. It's pretty awesome. And I took off whatever team I was riding for. I took their number and the names off. And I put on a bit of cardboard to keep as well. That was like 9 years ago.
So we've got a bit of a list of things to go through to talk about the Tour of Southland to bring you a few insights into pig loins. But one on the list, and let's just talk about it now because you're just talking about the team vehicle there now, so we can tick team cars off. Tell me, I want to know, is that each team has a team car, and if you get the race manual and book and things, and the teams, it'll tell you who their car driver is.
Yeah.
Is it like the Tour de France? Do they do the same? Are they buzzing up the side of the peloton? Oh, are they Black feeding smoke. Wheels and sticky bottles? Is there sticky bottles?
Yeah,
or
bro,
is there...
just like a race. Oh, full gas. Like I'd say, bro, team cars, like when you sign up, you know, every team's like got helpers, sponsors, and then their riders, you know. Each vehicle gets a radio. So you don't, riders don't get a radio. You got to go back to the car. So, but each car has got a radio that you can talk to comms and all that. Yep. Each car can talk to each other.
So that's the race radio.
That's the race radio. Yeah, yep. Yeah. And so comms can tell you off for not doing stuff. And when you want to feed, comms call you up like Versatile or ITM to the front. Your rider 96 wants a feed or whatever. And then they know to come up to the top. Yeah, but and like if you're like a well-funded team, like, you know, Black Spoke, Tellies, you know, Poundnet, usually they'll have two cars. They might have a proper car or they'll just get a van, like a nice van kind of thing. But it's pretty basic, really, eh? Pretty basic.
Right. Just but van. It's all part of the part of the show, part of the gig.
Yeah. Yeah. And then you
maybe that'd be like a role I could actually manage would be driver.
It's pretty hard, bro.
I'm a pretty good driver.
No. Yeah, you can be a good race car driver, but you need to know the race hard out because you got it. You're going under sense, bro. 80 k's an hour. You're in the bunch. Got to overtake the bunch to go to the breakaway. The bunch is coming in front of you. Like it's pretty skilled job to have. You really got to. Well, I'm not saying you can't do it.
That's what I was thinking. Like, I feel like you're like putting me in the gutter, bro.
Because I'm not, bro. I know good drivers that have nearly killed us. Like riders get hit by vans. Yeah. Like I got hit, bro. Okay, I got hit by
I've opened a can of worms here, people.
Cam Kowalski was in the yellow jersey up Bluff, and I fucking kid you not, he was like, I was going as hard as I could. He sat up the climb. You know, he's going to lose the jersey anyway. His fucking team van hit me up Bluff Hill, ran into me, and I didn't care. I was like, because I was riding with the yellow jersey, you know, I was like a numpty, but I was like, I loved it, but I was like, oh, I just got hit by a fucking van up Bluff Hill by a van. So, yeah, there's a lot. You can be going real fast or really slow, and still shit can happen, you know? Yeah, anyway.
Righto, come on then. Let's talk about this. Let's talk about the 2021 SBS Tour of Southland.
Right.
And I guess if there's a place we should start, we should probably start with the teams. Let's have a quick roll through the teams. We'll just quickly roll through the teams and you can talk about who maybe the GC contender, who may be a king of the mountain, or who may be in it for the biscuit.
Yeah, yeah. All right. So, like, fuck, we can't talk about every rider. We probably have to respect every single team. But, like, My favorite to win, I have to go with Michael Vink, like hands down. Like, I like no shit, just on Vink at the moment.
Vinky, our money is on you, so we know you're listening to our podcast,
bro. No shit, he is fucking ripping. Anyone that says he's not is talking shit. Like, mate, I've seen his power, and I've seen people get shelled at the ass on his power. He's fucking ripping, and I've seen his watts as well. Like, that's not just about watts, but he's won two. He knows how to win the race. He's got a fucking pretty strong team as well. Well, he's got a fucking strong team.
Yeah. Let's just say that Transport Engineering Tellies is the team.
Well, yes. So, okay. So that my opinion, bro, the three favorite teams are the three strongest teams. Well, let's go four. But the three guys that I believe anyway are Transport Engineering, so Tellies. And then you got Black Spoke. How do you say it? Bolton
Equities, Black Spoke Pro Cycling, but we'll call them Black Spoke Pro Cycling.
Yep. And we're going to that team soon. Then you got Poundnet, they've all been full gas for years.
Yep.
And then you've got Creation Signs.
Yes. I think that.
And I wouldn't say they're usually like a GC team. No disrespect to them because James Kenny runs a smooth ship and he has done so much for Spike. But, mate, they got some wicked riders and they can ride for GC 100%. Like, they'd be my dark horse there. They are weapons. But what they're known for is KOM jerseys, sprint jerseys, stages, getting amongst it and fucking really giving young guys a go and backing the guys. Like, bro, they're a weapon team, bro. And you should see the lineup they've got today. But should we go back to the
top? So let's go. Let's go off the top here. We're going to start just because this is how it's come out of the race manual, cool, to be fair, out of the official race manual. So Transport Engineering Tellies. Obviously, we've got Michael Vink there. He's their GC rider and overall contender for the SBS Tour of Southland.
Yep. Then you've got Ethan Batt. So a couple of years ago, he won under 23 KOM jersey, rode the front every single day of the Tour of Southland, ripped it in key moments for Vink. So he's like, I'd say he's his like little lieutenant or captain, you know, like, but bro, where anybody, here's the crazy. He's signed to Black Spoke. So he's just come from overseas of racing Black Spoke. Now he's coming back to ride for Vink, which is loyal and like an honest guy. And bro, he's a cool dude too.
So will that cause
drama
when the time comes?
No, definitely not, because these guys are like pretty straight up, eh? Like, and Ethan, bro, he's a good dude, eh? So, bro, he's a fucking weapon, beast. Then you've got Hamish Keast, all round, like strong beast weapon of a man. James Harvey, who I've kind of just met recently, like I know him through racing, rode the front last year with him, just saying I was weak, but he was strong. But like, bro, he was like an ex-rower, bro. Like he started late. Bro, last year was his first Tour of Southland was a couple of years ago. He wins yellow on the team's time trial, riding for Vink. That's out the gate. So good little bit of experience here, strong. Mike Phillips, bro. You got James from just come back from Europe as well, racing some race over there. Mike Phillips is a new one, big, strong powerhouse.
So we're going to talk about a few riders as they come up that aren't actually specifically road cycling discipline, that's for sure. And Mike Phillips falls into one of those.
Yeah, what does he do?
So he's an Ironman. Yeah. So I don't know, it'll be interesting to see if he's on a Ventum.
Big Watts. Yeah, Ventum. He's fully sponsored by a few people. But, bro, he can actually ride the front all day when Vink needs someone like that. So all round, bro, that team's fucking experienced and strong. Do you know what I mean?
Like, now, I better just caveat that because I just need to be sure there whether he's actually a triathlete or an Ironman, because those that are triathletes will get upset if I've said he's an Ironman, and those that are Ironman
doesn't do small stuff, bro. He does long distance stuff. He's a killer, total beast. Yeah, Brendan Ackroyd, my old manager from Placemaker as well. Pretty experienced, knows his shit, knows how to run a team. Yeah, awesome dude. This is the interesting one, bro. So then on to Blackspoke, who won it last year with Aaron Gate, right? Campbell Stewart, mean sprinter, bro. Did he win silver in the Olympics, Tokyo or something like that?
I think so.
Yeah, like total weapon, bro. If we go through this team here, bro, this one trips me out. This is fucking badass. So you got Campbell Stewart, total weapon, all round bike rider, bro. Can get in the mix with everything. Good leader. Then you got James Fush, ex-New Zealand road race champion, so won elite nationals, and he was under 20 fucking three by attacking the hitters, you know? So total, and I've been in the breakaway years ago when he was a little kid, bro. When he was like 17, he was dropping me when I was going the best, you know, like, so that, and now he's gotten older, he's a total weapon. Then you've got Luke Mudgway, bro, little sprinter, can climb, all-rounder, feistiest fuck in the bunch.
Yes. Will Luke be a GC contender?
My opinion is yes. I reckon yes. Yeah, my opinion. I don't want to tell that team what they're doing, but I think that would be my go, to be honest. But here's the dark horse for that team, in my opinion. Logan Curry, under 23 New Zealand time trial champion, went to Worlds, and he wasn't even in the time trial list for New Zealand. Him and his coach and whoever, they challenged through the ombudsman to get him in the time trial squad. He got put in, and then he was in the hot seat. That doesn't really mean shit, but he's still ripping. I think he might have got 6th or 7th in the world champs. Had a real good go in the road races in the break, ripping it as well. So he could be going for GC as well. Then you got Tom Sexton, ex-world champion on the track. Wicked 5-minute power, 20-minute power. Real cool young kid, feisty. Really going to fucking show his balls in the race. Then you got Joel Yates. So these guys are all been overseas. They're all just got out of quarantine now. But Joel Yates has raced around the world, raced for that. This development team in America, the all crit racing, I think it was a Harley Davidson team that he rode for, but a good dude, lots of experience, bro. Had a few wins and those types of things, but good breakaway rider, all round rider, can fucking rip it. So that team is like real strong. You know, they're all paid professionals as well. And then, like, if you move on, oh, and by the way, Mudgway's dad's in the car, he's the driver.
And has he done this before? Is this his gig?
I don't know, is it? I think he would have. He would be driving that 100%. But it's quite cool to have your dad.
Because I guess we go back to the car thing, and they've got the race radio. So are they technically the tactician as well? Or is there somebody else in there with them?
The race meeting the night before and of the morning. The riders, the captain of the team, and the DS, we're making decisions. Fuck yeah. There'll be an on-road captain.
Yeah,
100% for each team.
So the next team, PowerNet, supported by Tinelli Clothing, they're going on there. So they are back again and have been in the mix for some years now, huh?
Oh, bro, yeah, like PowerNet's always strong. Always been a bit of a I was always real scared of them. Like shit, I'm talking shit scared. They all ride round together like everyone does, but this is this like force kind of round. They've always had good riders, good sprinters, always in breakaways, fucking trying to win the race outright. And like, if you go to Ollie Jones, like, fuck, he's a total beast, bro. Like,
absolutely.
He was, I think last year or the year before, last year, bro, he was on the podium with the TT to go on the last day, and he didn't TT. He's not very time trialist, you know, but he's up there, which showed all year he's in the mix. Sorry, all stages.
Yeah.
He was in the mix to be on the podium, you know?
Yeah, I would definitely say that, you know, Ollie's got to be in that mix for the GC along the way, totally. And actually, Ollie, you know, he's a good cyclocrosser too, just FYI.
Last year, he attacked them up Remarkables as well.
Right.
But he's off the front. Like, he's a fucking bike racer. He loves it. And, like, he just got back from Europe on Campbell's team as well. And, like, they came back and I've been riding quite a lot with them. And, bro, they're fucking ripping. Like, hands down, they got the gas, bro. And they've come back for this. Then, bro, this is the other one for me, Alex Heaney. fucking weapon. He's finished on the podium a couple of years ago. Total beast, bro. Actually, I think his first Tour of Southland, he got in yellow off the team's time trial as well a while ago. But yeah, so Alex and Hamish Shurrell's actually look alike the last year or the year before. And like they were both on Poundnet, bro. And they're like, they dress the same bike and they're getting up the road and switching. And yeah, like he's a bike racer out and out. And he's finished on the podium before. Bro, then you move down to Paul Odlin. But he's chasing the silver jersey. But
I was just going to say, how old is Paul now?
Fuck if I know. I'm 40. He's got to be older than me. Surely.
Absolutely.
Like, bro.
Got to be.
Mate, this guy, he rocks up to club races with hairy legs. But then closer to Southland, bro, and I said to him a couple of weeks ago at a race, I was like, oh, the legs are shaving. He's like, how come you always notice that shit? I was like, bro, because Southland's coming up, brother. But yeah, he's like he's a fucking nutter on a bike. Eh?
Well, he goes all right at 200 kilometers too, doesn't he?
Oh, bro, yeah, smoked us. But he's done this. This is his bread and butter, you know? Yeah, then you've got Kian Watts, he rides for, I'm pretty sure he's Black Spoke as well, like Little Weapon. Zach Patterson, Little Weapon, Cambridge. Josh Haggerty, kind of all-rounder, he's rode for Tallies before, so just good like team riders there to kind of help out Poundnet, you know what I mean? So that's pretty solid racing right there. That's the kind of like right there. Then you move on to this team here, bro, Creation Signs, run by James Kenny, absolute weapon. Remember I said a while ago, I was like, oh, remember those mountain bikers doing Tour of Southland? And I thought they'd go shit. And they bummed me out because they were fucking gangster rippers. Ben Oliver. Been racing overseas at the moment. Handy on a bike. Any bike, basically.
Any bike.
Got the power. Can climb. Can actually sprint. You know, like, fuck, look out for him. So this is a real threat, this team. Now we're going through it.
Ben has come back from his European campaign with quite a lot of success. He was racing really well on that mountain bike.
Yeah, 100%. And he's got Ks for days in those legs. Then you shift down to the second place rider, under 23. This is interesting. They've got four under 23 riders that could all go for the under 23 jersey. We've forgotten about that. So you've got Ben Oliver, total fucking beast and weapon. Then you go down to George Jackson. Bro, this kid's a world champion on the track. I was on his first Tour of Southland team a couple of years ago. It might have been last year or the year before. Bro, he got on the stage on like the fourth day. And bro, this was the hardest stage of my life. I think he averaged like 360 watts, something. He told me the watts, bro, but it was phenomenal how this, on his first Tour of Southland, he's fucking ripping and getting in breaks. In the key moments, he's right there. So he's back, and he's back for action. And you know what? I think he's won the last two rounds of the North Island Racing Series as well. Like, smoked them. He's firing. Then okay, this is an interesting one for me. Joe Chapman. So the Chapman brothers, bro, like old school riders, have won KOM stages, sprint jerseys, like, you know, quite a well-known family. There's three brothers. I hope I'm getting this right. All real legends of Tour of Southland. They've all done it together on the same team, and they've all been aligned with this kind of team here. A cool story. My first Tour of Southland, we got dropped. There was a crash. We did 160K, just us three. We ran out of bottles. No, we had no cars with us. We had to stop at a petrol station. We stole the drinks and went back and paid the next day. Quick story about him. Then you've got Josh Burnett, cyclocross New Zealand champion.
Yeah, correct. Yeah, so he's just been crowned just before lockdown, actually. New Zealand's latest cyclocross champ.
Yeah, and he's a good young kid. And, bro, he did the UCI tour up with Hills, was it last year? And he got on the podium there on one of the stages, the hilltop finishes. So, bro, this kid can climb. He's obviously got that explosive power from cyclocross. Then we move down the line to young Jack Drake. This kid can climb.
Who we've talked about today already.
Yeah. And his last year, first Tour Southland, bro, I was going full gas for brakes for 90 minutes, and so was he. Then he still gets in the brake and rips it as well. This guy's got confidence. Some people might say they mistake it for arrogance, but fuck, he's there to race, and he's come back, and he's flying. He's extremely light. But the good thing is, if these boys all look after him, he'll be right and safe to the hills.
Does he come back with pressure on? Do any of these riders that are now either just signing to pro teams or coming back from pro teams and coming back from overseas – is the pressure on them to actually show how good they are? And
I reckon, bro, it's a Tour of fucking Southland in New Zealand. You know, I think a lot of it we'll put on ourselves. Like every year, and I was a shit kicker, but I'd put pressure on myself to try and get in the break to win the stage. Like really try and focus. And if you go good, people are watching, it's on TV. Your coach has helped you. I've been working full time since I was 26, you know, like, you know, you put a lot on the line. You actually do want to go good because you're representing yourself, you know, those types of things. But 100%, they want to go pro, they want to get a contract, and getting a good result here is only going to help sponsors, team, people, family, you know, a bit more commitment. So let's hope he goes good up those climbs and that team can work well together, and or, you know, whatever their team plan is going good, you know. Then you skip down the line to their last rider, this guy's a boss, bro. Last year's KOM winner. And I know how good he is because I've been in the race with him. When I'm fucking in the river getting and put in the gutter and he's still there fighting for the KOM points, getting in breakaways, you know, that whole tactician of watching the race, don't worry about going now because the KOM threat's not there, but going and then picking stages. And he spent a year overseas as well and he's come back for it as well. So, fuck, what, you know, total beast, really. So that, my opinion, without disrespect to any of the other teams, though, the other four teams that I've got some serious backed up firepower.
Yeah, so those probably what you call the four main teams that, if you had to pick a GC rider, you're a winner of the 2021 SBS Tour of Southland, you're going to pick from there.
Yeah.
And not only just because they've got a hitter on there, but they've got the support package as a team to go around them.
Yeah, 100%. Yeah, 100%. And then if we go down to central benchmark makers, which I would call there, yeah, so that's James Williamson's gig. James Williamson is ex-New Zealand champion, winner of the Pioneer, like fucking all round, like old school. He's an older dude as well. Got a family, runs a bike shop down there, like, from Alexander, real cool dude, runs the Prospector, which is a wicked race. So he might be there for breakaways. I was in the break with him for about half an hour because then I got dropped. But on the remarkable stage, like, just is so experienced and he can help these young guys. And when I talk about young guys, who else? Ethan Rose, the young mountain biker that's just come back with Ben.
I'm really interested to see how Ethan goes here. I've never actually really seen Ethan ride a road race a road bike. So this is going to be really interesting. And I hope they don't. I hope the expectation for him's not there and that he can just get the experience, because in time to come he's gonna be handy,
bro. I like this. He's a nice young kid and he's an mate, exceptionally skilled up mountain biker. Fuck, this is the deep end, my bro. So like, this is the one I'm gonna be watching young Ethan like pretty hard out, bro. It's pretty epic. I don't know if he's ever done a 2-day tour, 3-day tour, and a riding with the big boys, you know, but like, this is awesome. You just put in the baptism of fire, and he's got James Williamson to kind of guide him through and help him support every day.
You got
to
start somewhere, right?
Oh, no, bro, exactly. No, I reckon it's awesome, bro. It's fucking adding so much kind of mana to the Tour of Southland, you know?
Yeah.
And then if we shift down to Business South cycling team, so this team's run by Alan Dunn. Alan Dunn's a bloody legend down there. Like, he's rallied up all these businesses to put in a little bit of coin each to try and help young guys take part in the Tour of Southland. And if I just talk about just a couple of guys, so Travis Kane's done over 20 Tour of Southlands. Like, this guy's a loose cannon. He's a good dude. Like, trust me. But how do you do that many Tour of Southlands?
Yeah, that's a lot, isn't it?
That is. It's a lot. It's pretty epic, bro. Pretty badass. Now, the one I will talk about is Adam Bidwell. Now, I rode with Adam Bidwell on the Oxford Edge team, more Stephen Markham's. And he's young guy, his brother's a good rider as well. This kid can climb, like, hard out. But can he get to the bottom of climb with the front group in the key moments? That'll be the test for young Adam. But young, eager, young little kid. And you know what? He packs a little sprint on him, bro.
So if they're going to get into the climb, have they got enough people in the team to get into the bottom of that climb?
I don't know. They're just going to he'll have to swing on the coattails of the other teams. These other teams aren't really like riding the front every day and those types of things. And I don't know if that's what these teams are kind of set up for. I mean, they will ride for that if that's what happens. Fuck yeah.
And in this instance, then, in that case, does that mean they will probably single out like one stage of the tour? Will they go, this is our stage, this is what we're going to focus on, we're going to have a crack at this one?
Well, it's whatever Alan, the DS, wants to decide, to be honest. You know, he might say,
I'm not asking Alan, real. I'm asking you.
Oh, well, fuck, I would be. But here's the little hidden gem here. Raphael. How do you say Rafa's name?
Raphael.
He's from France. He beat Vink in a time trial, a 12K time trial, by 1.6 seconds 4 weeks ago. He smoked me by 30 seconds.
So he probably goes okay.
This guy can ride a bike. He won state champs in Aussie. He lives in Perth. So he is ripped. He's like 6 foot something, and he's a monster on a bike. So this is his first Tour of Southland. So baptism of fire. Let's see what he's got. That'd be cool to see the last time trial day as well. Then you got little Liam Morrison from Christchurch. He's riding good. Now, this is a cool story about Liam. Now, so he didn't finish last year because of a huge crash at like 60 k's an hour. And he still finished the stage, but he broke bones, fingers, and ended up in hospital. And he also didn't finish the cycle classic because he got taken down by a big, crazy crash as well. So, like, kudos to Liam for, like, training up. He's flying at the moment to try and, you know, finish another Tour of Southland, you know, his first Tour of Southland. And I actually want him to finish good. And you never know. He could be in the breakaway. You never know. Who are we on to next, bro?
So let's slide through here. We've got Base Solutions Racing. And,
this is a good team. Bro.
It is a good team. This is a good team.
We might have fucked up. This could be a team's time trial team as well. They'll be solid. Regan Goff.
Yep.
Bro, fucking, if you don't know who he is, Google him. He's a hitter. Not bloody nice guy. Well experienced, amazing track rider. So much results you could write a book on. Okay, Hugo Jones, flying New Zealand track program. He got fourth last year in the Wiggle in this breakaway. I started it, then I got dropped off the KOM. And he actually stayed away and he got fourth. The breakaway, it split up. He got fourth. So I'm actually picking him for a stage this year. He's actually flying at the moment. Then we'll go to Keegan Hornblow, good rider as well. He's been training hard, part of the Skoda team back in the day. All-round rider. He'll be looking for breakaways as well. Bro, another mountain biker.
Yeah, Cam Jones. Cam Jones, one of my favorites. Cam Jones is a bloody good guy, young fella who has nothing but smiles on his face the whole time. That guy has got the attitude that everybody should have.
Bro, he, like me and Kate with the quarry, stops and helps us ride, shows us what to do.
He's awesome.
He gives time, and now he's done the Tour of Southland. I was stoked
when I saw that Cam was going to ride that. That was awesome.
Yeah, and you look at, you're like, okay, so.
And I got to tell you this. Do you know what Cam Jones was doing while riding his trainer in lockdown in MIQ?
He was
listening to us.
Oh, the bro. Hey, yeah, that's
shout
awesome.
Out Cam Jones. You're the mentor. Listening to the Cycling Collab podcast while in MIQ.
Yeah, yeah. Hey, bro. Hey, how nervous will they all be for the team's time trial?
Oh,
fuck, bro. That is a baptism of fire. So that's a really good team. Like,
how many of these teams will have practiced for the team's time trial?
Oh, everyone lives everywhere, so maybe not. But a lot of these guys have all done it before. They know what to expect, but you know, so, you know, that's just how it is. But they'll be the day before, they'll do 3 or 4 laps and maybe do a hot lap as well. Pretty epic, really. So that's another good, solid team, bro. So look out for breakaways, maybe sprint jersey. You never know what's going on there. Then go down to Quality Foods. Who are all these guys from? I don't know most of these guys. These guys are, half of them have all done it before. Good riders. Probably looking for breakaway stages, kind of stuff like that.
Yep.
Mitchell, young guy, under 23. He's a good little rider, actually. That's actually pretty epic. Team Couplins. Oh, hold on, bro. This is another fucking strong team. How did we miss this? So these guys are actually, Glenn Haddon can time trial. He's got second, I think, a few times in the last. He can time trial, bro. He's a fucking weapon. Nick Kyrgyzou. So mean track rider, wicked results. Love Southland. He'll be up there trying to find a stage. Ari Scott, obviously under 23, another weapon. Liam Chappell, he's a weapon, bro. I'm pretty sure he looks like he's a Māori fella. He's like got the mean 10. I was like, is he Māori? I wonder what is where he's from, to be honest. I'm not sure. So obviously that's another good team as well. Well supported and are ready to kind of whip some ass as well. Oh, bro, fucking the Oxford Edge team. So Bailey O'Donnell, world champion on the track, fucking hitter. Road to Vink teams a couple of years ago. The Richard Lawson. So Richard's done, I think, 2 Tour of Southland before. Bro, he was in this main split probably 5 years ago when Michael Torkler was in, the whole GC got split. And he had to pull out because the derailleur broke and the team bike was on the car an hour behind the race helping another rider. Then the car later got DQ'd. So Richard had to pull out of the Tour of Southland because the car got DQ'd. It wasn't his fault. So he's come back for a bit of fire. Michael Van Hennigan. So this will be first Tour of Southland. Guy Yarrell's climbing pretty fucking well as well. So he got second on the weekend to Ollie Jones.
And we'll come back to Oxford Edge shortly once we just bolt through the last of these because I want to talk a little bit about that. They're another team sponsored by New Zealand's Tinelli Clothing. And yeah, I just want to talk a little bit. We talked about your really cool bibs easy. Up there. But we'll come back and talk a little bit Sweet. Of tech shortly.
Yeah, easy.
Carry on.
So then if you go down to the Share the Road team, which is another cool team, bro. So this is the coolest story for me. A photographer that does the Tour of Southland, James Judd, has entered the Tour of Southland, and he's going to try and finish the Tour of Southland.
That's
Fuck
cool.
yeah. It's awesome. Sam Ritchie from Timaru. He's got top 10s. He can sprint. He's a kind of an all-rounder. He'll be looking for stages, in my opinion. He's actually a fucking weapon. Ride, scratch, hitter. Then you got the man of the team, Matt Zenovich. This guy has won KOM, sprint, stages, GC. He's a fucking weapon. I'm not sure if he's like training like he used to, but, bro, this guy's a weapon. Jake Merritt, he can climb, and that's probably enough from that team. But, yeah, good all-round team. Cameraman's a man.
And so that's, that's Share the Road. Macaulay Ford.
Yeah.
But now the lads.
Yeah, the boys. Micro Home Circuit Asphalt. Yeah, the boys. So you got
a big shout.
Yeah, Mitchell Sincott, good mate of mine. He's an all-round dude. He's a master.
And a passionate cyclist who, again, Circuit Asphalt, pouring some money in here. So just taking his passion and really
100%.
Running with it.
And here's a cool story. So Campbell Pithy, so Circuit Asphalt actually helps get Campbell Pithy and myself to the first Tour of Southlands years ago.
Right.
Yeah, so a cool story. Awesome. Does a lot for the community. You've got Jeremy Ingles. He'll be trying to finish and do what he can for the team as well. He's done. Is he a hitter? He is a hitter, Jerry. We love you, Jerry.
Shout out, Jerry.
Anyway, I don't know how many tours he's done, but fuck, he's experienced. He knows how to run. Oh, 100%. He knows what to do. If the boys need something, he'll be the first supporter's hand up. So he's all around GC. Campbell Pithy back from Europe. This is the best I've ever seen Campbell ride. I don't know what he's doing. I don't want to put pressure on him, but fuck, Campbell, you need to rip some legs off, bro. Yeah, so good rider. Max Beckett. The first Tour of Southland was last year with me, and fuck, he should be getting breaks.
Yeah,
little.
He's my neighbor. Just lives over the park from me.
Yeah, good dude, bro. Like, and he's got a kick on him, bro. And Max, get in the break, bro. Now, bro. Okay, just quickly, Alex Frame used to ride for a trick.
A-Frame, yeah.
Beat me in the stage. He beat me, took yellow in one of the stages, Tiana stage. But he's come back. He won Winter Worlds. he won the series there. That was his full circle, World Tour to Winter Worlds. And now he's lining up for the boys in Tour of Southland. So to rally the troops and had a bit of firepower there for the boys. And do you know what? He does very limited training. And he's actually going pretty well for that big dog. So, yeah, all kudos to the A-Frame. And, bro, tell me a bit about this dude, Dougal Allen, bro, because I don't know shit about him.
Who the hell's Dougal Allen? Dougal.
I don't know. He's a weapon, though.
You're out of your depth here because this man runs as well and kayaks. Dougal Allen, everybody out there should know who Dougal Allen is. He's a multi-time Kathmandu coast-to-coast winner. A guy who, you know, he, again, has got the right attitude. He is just a super nice guy and has time for everybody.
Yeah.
Loves a good block of chocolate. Yeah. But he will be a diesel engine.
Yeah.
He, this is Dougal's first foray into road bike racing, essentially.
Yeah.
Normally riding on his own out in on a TT position.
Yeah.
But so this will be really interesting to see how Dougal goes in this environment.
Can he
the
climb?
Powerhouse.
Is he a GC rider?
The guy is an all-rounder, muscle.
Now, can he? My thinking with this is, but this is all my bullshit. So probably, but can he win the game of chess against these guys that are like vicious assassins in the game of chess of bike racing?
I don't know that that'll be his job.
Yeah.
Okay.
True.
So I just don't think that'll be. You know, if the boys are being smart there, if manager Chris Lawrence manages them well, and actually, we talk about the drivers, the managers, and whatnot, and I know Chris Lawrence very well, and he's just super passionate dude. Has given so much time to cycling, managing teams at Tour of Southland, managing the benchmark girls back in the day, and all of those things. So so many volunteers people doing things for the love of cycling.
100%. Then moving on from the boys, good luck boys, is BJ Carter Builders. So bro, this team's all under, there's one master and they're all under 23. So young guy Sam Medlicott, who's he's lean as hell. I call him a bit of a climber actually. So and this is the cool thing about this team. The managers are Lazenby. How do you say it? But it's Lazer. So he's managed teams for Tour of Southland since I've done them. He just knows his shit. He runs the team well, and he gives back to the sport. He's also at NZ Comms, for all the races around New Zealand. Good dude.
And the team driver, because the most important person, the team driver, I was actually riding with on Sunday in a bunch out of Timaru. I was down in Timaru for the weekend.
Man.
Found a bunch to ride with, these old guys who like to ride bikes. And turns out it's Jim Ryder who's the driver.
That's
for them.
Awesome. Bro, moving on to the ITM. This is actually awesome. So again, I rode for ITM, I think, 3 years. Cool team, cool sponsors getting behind it. They help you out, food. You know, they do everything for you. But these guys are all from Wellington, which I fucking love. And so if we just go back to the managers, Tristan Thomas. So he owns Wheelworks. They make the wheels in Wellington.
He's a good bugger.
Yeah. Like all around into cycling in general, you know.
Yep.
And so he's obviously roped a lot of the boys together. And they're three masters. Go for that jersey, boys. And I don't know what they'd be doing as in terms of are they going to all trying to finish the Tour of Southland, sneak into a break later on? So
that'll be a fun team. Callum Kennedy on there.
Yeah, bring the boys.
Yeah,
and you imagine all the training they've done together leading up to it. Like, it's going to be interesting to follow all those boys. So good luck. And then you've gone down to C. Brown's Builders.
Yep.
You've got a couple of under 23 there. Hunter Goff from Invercargill, I think he's got a bit of a kick on him. David McCormick's back, yeah boy. Who's the manager there? Jack Broome.
I'm taking a punt, but Sam Clark Fakatane. I haven't actually seen. Here I don't know how many Sam Clarks there are, but this may be a Dougal Allen Sam Clark battle off within the.
Here we go.
The
thing here
there.
We
so
go. Cool.
Sam Clark, another coast to coasters. I'm only assuming Sam that's actually you that's on that list.
Dougal put him in the gutter.
Yeah, Dougal.
And then if you go to On Your Bike, so bro. This young guy who was a mechanic last year, Blair Page. So it's good that this will be his first Tour of Southland. There's a lot of masters, Yeah, there's four masters as well, so good luck to those boys. And their manager is a dear clerk, so that's Tim Rush's mother, who's won the Pioneer. She's a good lady. She goes down there. She's an accountant. So that's all the team. So, fuck, bro, how good is this going to be?
That is a great field, isn't it? There's some absolute stunning riding going to come up.
Oh, yeah.
Starting next weekend, starting next Sunday, the 31st or something, I think it is. Actually. Yeah. I should get that. Okay, so we need to keep rolling around here, otherwise people will stop listening to us, bro.
Word.
But the course, let's have a quick stage breakdown and maybe pick a couple of stages. Well, we'll talk about day one for a start.
Yeah, cool.
And then maybe pick a couple of stages and a couple of key moments that are going to be the key bits to the race.
Yeah, cool. So if we just go, the start of the Tour of Southland, the team's time trial around Queen's Park. Bro, this is like, I think I did my best 5-minute power, 520 watts around there. And I'm talking, if you haven't done your warm-up, you are out the ass and you let the team down because you can't pull, your lactate's in your legs and there's like four corners, bro. So you're standing, everyone's holding the bikes. So if you haven't done a Tour of Southland before or a team's time trial, holy shit, bro, it's pretty big countdown and you're into it. Every second counts. So.
And how many across the line does it count?
Oh, it's four.
It is four.
Yeah.
So four. Team of six, you can drop two.
Yeah, bro.
So you can be out the ass if you need to be.
Yeah, and last year, bro, I was just out the ass and Lawrence Pithy brought me back up because I was the fourth rider. Fuck me. Out the gate. So that's team's time trial. And, bro, long range weather forecast, rain for 3 days.
It's going to make it tough.
And then if you move on to the next stage, which Sally, the new manager of the Tour of Southland or director, she's put in a crit there around Queen's Park on the same day. I think it's an hour and a half to 2 hours after. So you've got a 42-kilometer crit, which is like, it used to be the team's time trial was boom, get yellow and all the jerseys. Now, that will probably happen, but maybe not actually. They'll probably wait to the crit. So now you've got potentially in the wet, how long is that going to, like, bro, this is full gas, you know?
And the trick there will just be to stay upright, right?
Yeah,
And stay out of trouble.
At the peloton, you go at the back and you're at the back. And then I'm like, okay, is time cut going to come into play here? Because all these boys that are new to it and younger and not so strong, man, these boys are going to be fucking ripping around there. Like, the average speed will be well over 50 for this. And my thing is, I would say Black Spoke are going to win that stage with, who's the sprinter who won the Tokyo? Stuart, what's his name? Campbell Stuart. He'll be my pick for that one there. And like, you'd be stupid. Like, if I was on one of those teams here, those three or four teams would just be riding the front the whole time and keep the pace up. So just stop all the attacks to keep your team riders up the front because that's the start of the whole week. You know what I mean? You do not want to lose your GC rider split.
Straight
lose
away. 5 minutes. That's right. There.
Basically, you're fucked. So get on the front, ride the front, manage it for the whole thing and lead out, even lead another team out for the sprint, you know, just to be up there kind of thing. Yep. But fuck, that's going to be so grippy, bro.
And so that's day one. That's Sunday, the 31st of October. Yeah, yeah. So there's sort of the prologue in stage one. Monday rolls around for stage two, and that's 172 kilometers. And again, Sally has thrown in a bit of a curveball into stage two.
Bro, with two gravel sections. So we get this new female director, which is pretty cool, actually. And she's now added a crit in, and now she's chucked in gravel, which is fucking awesome, eh? In my opinion, because I love this kind of crazy stuff. I don't know about non-professionals who don't have sponsored bikes and teams, wheels everywhere.
Gotta be a bit hard on the gear.
Yeah, a bit hard on the gear. So, you know, there might be a bit of groveling, you know, and like complaining about that. Not really, but, you know, most guys will be loving it. Some guys against it, but it's in there. Imagine winning the first gravel stage of Tour of Southland.
Yeah, it'll be something to put in the history book.
Yeah. 100%. That's a nuggety stage as well. And then you're moving on the next stage to Tiana. So that's the stage that Roller used to get me to focus on every year, basically, that he was coaching me. And that, in my opinion, man, I want that stage to be lit up Black Mount. But it's a good stage to get into the breakaway. Nah, I got second or third, two-thirds actually. But bro, I had a bike change. Brendan Ackroyd actually got me a bike. They got me a bike from some house. They drove it to me mid-stage and I had to have a bike change. I'll blame that's why I got third to fucking A-frame posse. Jokes. The Tiana stage. And the thing about that stage there, bro, it starts, there's a KOM like 3K in. So all these stages, there's KOM points and sprint points. Yep. So people going for these jerseys. Bro,
blame for the jerseys over here.
Yeah, that's where all the points are added up. So for me, Black Mount's quite an important day to try and get in the breakaway later on, waiting after all the first rollers, heading towards get over Black Mount, then try and win the stage there. And then, bro, then you're going to where? The Remarkables. Fuck, bro, that climb is insane. Yeah, it's pretty hard. Then you go up this devil staircase as well, which the teams are usually controlling. I wouldn't say it's easy, but usually a good tempo on the front you can sit on, but you're doing like 300 plus watts. You know?
Is it a day for a breakaway?
Nah, fuck no, the hilltop. Nah, GC.
So you wouldn't stay away?
No way. Someone wants to win that for sure. And that's where, in my kind of opinion, that's where the first GC will be set.
Well, let's think about this then. If a breakaway goes and the GC contenders, the climbers, don't go, how much of a head start can they give them?
Oh,
well, how much can you pull back on the remarkables?
Depends who they are. You wouldn't let like Ben Oliver, you know, Jack Drake up the road, nothing like that. You wouldn't give them a minute, in my opinion, because I'd want, you know what I mean? You just wouldn't do it. So they probably wouldn't be allowed in the breakaway, to be really honest. The captains would be controlling the final
race. Just keep shutting it down.
Yeah, 100%. But that's where you're probably going to get your bigger time gaps to kind of see where a minute, 30 seconds, 10 seconds are, you know, where you can gain, who's got good legs, who hasn't. Bro, the next day, Bluff Hill. Fuck me. Just to get to Bluff Hill was hard. If there's blowing crosswinds, the whole pelotons and echelons, the front group's going to be 8 people. No joke whatsoever. The fucking, the groupetto is 50 people and it's split to shreds, you know? So Bluff Hill is a pretty epic stage to watch on the TV as well. But that's another wicked stage where you see who's got good legs. It's a shorter climb. And then you go to stage 651 kilometers to Gore, hard day on the legs after all what you've just done there. And if someone's like behind on like 2 points on the sprint jersey or KOM, the breakaway just doesn't go. It's continually going because people are chasing the jerseys, you know, whatever's up for grabs. And that's where you're going to see fucking people getting dropped and losing time, you know, and having to race hard to make time cut. Because you've got to remember, bro, that if you get dropped on the first stage and you're riding with 4 people, you've got to do that whole stage with those 4 people. But you can't just sit up. You've got to like ride as basically steady, as hard as you can to make time cut. Because if you don't, you're not allowed to start the next day. Every day's like that.
And each stage got a different time cut depending on the stage.
On the winner's time. It's like 20%, or they might make it depending on if there's a big crash or whatever. There's a little bit of leeway there, but it's not, you can't just turn up to South and go, oh, I'll just finish it. Nah, bro, you won't be allowed to start the next day. You don't make time cut. That's the whole hardest thing about the whole fucking thing, you know? Then you move on to the last day. And bro, this is the thing. You've got the time trial. So you'll have Glenn trying to win the time trial and the Masters jersey to put time on Paul Odlin there, because Paul Odlin is usually in front around then because he's up the road or whatever, or you never know. But this is where the time and GC really counts. You had Ollie on the podium and he was off the podium after the TT. You know, you had Aaron Gate at a wicked, phenomenal TT. You had Vink at a good TT. You had Bond put a minute into Vink, but Vink still won yellow. You know, it's so amazing, that TT. That's in the morning. And then you got the 77K stage in the afternoon, which usually if there's no wind or whatever, it's just a big team's time trial. Just ride the front as hard as you can and get to the fucking finish.
I was just going to say, because, you know, potentially the race is done at the end of the individual time trial. Like, if you can put yourself in the right place there, then your team should be able to shut down anything else going on.
Yeah. Depending on whether and how good your team is and how well they're pulled up and if no crashes and stuff like that. But usually it's just like last year, like Bond was going hard out. Like the other year, Bond was just ripping him. But nah, bro. Like
it's not quite riding down the Champs-Élysées.
No, bro. This is a hard stage. Like half the peloton was dropped last year in the first 5K.
Right.
Yeah, if there's crosswinds.
It's all on to the end.
Bro, right, like when the first right-hand corner, it's in the gutter up a false sat climb, and then it's rolling hills, then flat. Then you've got to go around Queen's Park like 4 times in the rain. Like, bro, no. It's done when you cross the finish line on that last stage. Definitely not like fucking Tour de France. Yeah, no way. But, bro, that is one hell of a course. And, bro, shit, I'll be shitting my pants if this is my first Tour of Southland. Woo! Your boy.
So that's the course. That's the quick rundown through there. We just got a couple more things I just want to talk about for those that are maybe first-time listeners or new to this whole thing. Just a bit of Reon experience here. Yeah. One, just quickly, tell me about eating on the bike. 6 days. Have we got 7 days?
Oh, fuck. That's the hardest part of it for me.
That's right.
And I've got problems with my intestine on my bowel, so I've always found it hard to get nutrition and continuity. But, bro, if you don't eat on day one, you're out the race on day 2 or 3. No shit. You have to continually eat. You're eating for the next days in preparation for recovery. It's so important, like down to what you're eating in the stage. Like, you're eating solid food, you know, and then obviously the gels and the hydration. Getting sunburn can fuck you in 3 days. Yeah. Dehydration, it all catches up on you. So it's all about getting that. And as soon as you finish that stage, all the teams are set with all their Coke, Sprite, the little simple sugar straight away, protein drinks, rice, pasta, whatever the team individual food needs, it's all set out. And then 2 hours later, they get into the main meals, and it's just like keep eating and eating and eating, stay hydrated. That is the hardest part.
Until you can't eat anymore.
Yeah, that's the hardest part. Like, obviously, you don't want to like overdo it so you strain your body heart out, but you've got to be quite onto it. And if you haven't done that and you go there and do that, you're setting your whole system up for failure. So you've got to, that's why everybody should have been doing it prior, yep. You know? But yeah, food is like 90% of it, 100%.
You know, it's obviously the eating off the bike at the end of the day, you talk about that, yeah. But that's pretty easy. But yeah. Trying to do it on the bike,
when
you're doing 50K an hour in the middle of a bunch is just not the easiest thing either.
Yeah, yeah. So looking for moments, say like again, Southland's pretty cool because it's got later starts. So you only have to get up at 7-3 hours before you have your main meal of carbohydrates. I always stick with like rolled oats, bananas, brown sugar to get it down to yogurt, protein yogurt, but like a big solid carb meal. And then like no shit, bro, because of the stages are so full gas for an hour to 90 minutes, I always have like two full bars, like I have a bar an hour before the race start and half an hour try and get half a bar or another full bar. And then to try and get through that first hour of like, because you can't eat when you're doing that speed and corners and attacking and trying to stay upright. And that's when I'm just having gels or my carb mix, but you need that solid stuff in you. And then as soon as the race settles, the brake's gone, it sits up, have a bar, have half a bar. But it's so... fuck, it's hard to eat when you're nervous before the race. You know, that's the whole part of it, you know. But, bro, so vital, so vital. Whoever doesn't eat ain't going to finish.
Yep.
No doubt.
Who eats deers? Who deers wins? Who eats wins? Who eats wins?
Yeah.
Okay. I guess you talked about your set of bibs there that I don't know. Some reason I really want to see you wearing those, but that sounds a bit wrong, doesn't it?
Yeah.
But how wrong it can go, like, you know, you can wear the incorrect bib or incorrect shirt or whatever for one day or whatever, wrong it can go. So custom sort of clothing, how big a difference does the right clothing, the right length, all that stuff?
Oh, bro, I'm not disrespecting that brand either. What I'm saying is that was like 9 years ago. So technology's changed. You know, everything's changed, you know, and so they were pretty hardcore. But so... the first thing is, if you're turning up to a team and you've been supplied the right fitting vest, the nice fitting bibs, the nice cut socks, the stuff that actually fits you, you got the right, the sizing right, you just feel like $1 million bucks and you're like a little army going to war together. You look right, you look strong, and you feel good. It's just this little half percenters that add up, you know, to like enhance you and the team. You know, you fucking feel a part of something. It's awesome. But these days, like Oxford Edge and Pownet Tinelli, so it's like, I've ridden for Tinelli for like their clothing for a long time. And like, because Robin Reed, who's done Com Games, I've ridden on most of his teams, you know, in the Elite Series, but he was like always involved in getting us to test stuff. But the cool thing is like, you can change your leg length as well, which is pretty awesome. Yep. I always say that skin is slow. So the longer the bibs and the longer the arms, you can get them like measures to your size. You can order, you know, those types of things. So the skin suits are pretty gangster as well. So my thing is that having the right kit that you feel good in and you know is fast, it helps. It makes you fast, in my opinion. You know, the little 1%ers, you know, 100%.
Marginal gains.
Fucking nice, boy. So my thing is kits. The kit's important. I mean, it's all about the legs, the riders, the training, the team, the food. Everything is combined. When you've got it all combined together, shit's going to happen, you know?
And finally, for Tour of Southland special pre-race for 2021, I'm going to put you on the spot.
Fuck you.
Outright predictions.
Yeah.
For all the jerseys, let's do yellow last. So
okay.
Outright for our silver riders, the Masters. Can you put one on that?
We're going to have to go to. Hold on, mate. Hold on. I want to pronounce the bro's name right. His last name. I'm going to have to go to Glenn Haddon.
Glenn Haddon, yep. Okay.
The time trial weapon, the machine from Cooper.
Because we're going to see how many of these, at the end of the tour, how many of these you actually get right.
Oh, shit, okay.
Sprinter's jersey, who's going to get the sprinter?
Okay, now this one's hard because I believe someone in Black Spoke is going to get that. And I'll say Foosh.
Okay, Foosh. But we'll put a little caveat there that Black Spoke BSP are going to win that, right?
Fuck. Okay, can I put a name next to that as well? George Jackson from Creation Signs.
So you're having a dollar each way. No, is that what you're doing?
Yeah, come on, George is okay. Now who else?
So most combative.
Oh no,
that might be a bit hard to tell.
That's changed now. That's changed to another jersey. That's like the good sportsman every stage. Oh, okay, yeah, that's changed.
Well, that won't be you.
No.
Jokes.
No.
King of the Mountain.
Well, I'm gonna honestly back to Creation Signs. I'm gonna go Paul Wright again.
Right.
Going back to back win that stage, my bro.
And right, no pressure, Paul Wright. That's on you to go back to back for that.
Yeah, and if that's what the team are doing, you know, I'm just really not sure. under 23 jersey.
Under 23.
Bro, this is hotly contested, bro. Like, this is as good. Like, this yellow is, well, yellow.
Well, I didn't do the numbers, but I was actually going to add up whether there's actually more under 23s in this race than anything else, because it just about is.
Bro, it's so interesting. If the team rode for Jack, I don't know, Jack Drake.
Right.
Under 23. I have to say it. But he might be going for GC. He might say stuff under 23. I'm going for yellow, but fuck it.
He could do, because of course, well, at the end of the race, you can win both, but you can't hold both while you pass your jersey on during the race.
Someone else has to wear it. Yeah, 100%.
So, yellow. And I don't even think I need to ask this,
Michael Vink is a mate of mine, but also on his dedication to training and what he does, like on and off the bike, like, and he's a strong mofo at the moment.
And not only that, he's a huge supporter of our podcast.
Yeah, true.
As
but
well.
Like, and saying, if I thought someone could beat him, like, I'd say them as well. Like, I'm not being biased to Vink, but I just because I've been
he's
on his wheel,
goods.
I've been dropped off his wheel, I've seen his power, I've seen what he's done, and I know he's a crafty little shark as well. And that's not disrespecting any other rider from Black Spoke, Poundnet, whatever. Bro, these guys aren't coming here to fucking give the tour to Vink. I can fucking tell you that. These guys are coming to rip his legs off, to try and split it in the crosswinds, to isolate him. Like, so this is going to be a battle, bro. This is awesome.
It's on for
fuck yeah.
For the 2021 SBS Tour of Southland, which starts at the end of this current week, so the 31st of October, running right through to the 6th of November. You heard it here first. Of course, don't forget that there's no malice intended. These are just opinions of myself and Reon, but more Reon than me. So all the hate mail to him if you need to.
Put him in the gutter.
We'll put him in the gutter. But of course, so once you've listened to this, next best thing to do is watch the Tour of Southland, follow along there.
Yeah.
There'll be coverage on television. There'll be plenty of social media, no doubt, of the Tour of Southland. And then the next key bit is to tune back in again in a fortnight's time.
Yeah.
And we will break the race down. We'll tell you who won, where it went, how it went wrong, how it went right.
Yeah.
And all of those things.
And just on this, I think this was the first Tour of Southland that was potentially going to be cancelled. It's never missed a beat. And this is, we had I don't want to go on about the case in Blenheim, and everyone's like, oh, it's going to be off, you know, but it's like, we were nearly getting there.
And we know there's been some riders now not breaking any COVID laws, some riders actually foresaw what was going on,
ages bailed
out of the North Island and have been down here training in the South Island.
And they got out of MIQ from Christchurch and they stayed here. They didn't go back. So that's awesome. Yeah. But bro, it's going to be interesting to see who has the legs after MIQ.
Yeah,
locked in the room for 2 weeks.
Totally. Oh,
hey, bro. Actually, rumor on the street is Mudgeway's done over 20 hours on 20 hours on Zwift. Apparently, so he's flying.
It's a lot of Zwifting, isn't it? That's a lot of Zwifting.
Yeah, ready.
Right on, my bro.
Sick.
That was the shizzle, eh?
Yeah.
Tour of Southland pre-race special. Thank you so much for listening. Thank you for watching. Don't forget, over on YouTube, give us a like, hit the thumbs up to this episode and every other episode you watch. Hit subscribe so you don't miss another one of these, the next one of these. Spotify and Apple Podcasts is where you can download us and have a listen on your bike, in the car, however you go, wherever you listen to it. Don't forget, give us a follow on the old Instagram and Facebook. We like to share a few things there, and we'll be sharing a bit of Tour of Southland over the weekend as well. And any complaints about Reon, feel free to send them to the cyclingcollab@gmail.com. If there's anything you want us to touch on, talk about, whatever, get a hold of us, give us a message. We're happy to hear from you.
Yeah.
In the meantime, thank you very much. Thank you, Reon. You're a GC, mate.
Good luck to everyone down there. I keep it upright, fucking race hard, put them in the gutter, put them in the crosswinds, fucking everything. But
actually, if you're listening, you're watching, and you're supporting the Tour of Southland, we want to see a put them in the gutter sign on the TV. We want to see holding a put them in the gutter sign on TV. Yeah. If you do that and we can identify you who you are, there will be a t-shirt coming your way.
You know, when you get interviewed on the TV, put them in the gutter, you've got to get in there.
Yeah,
come on,
somebody,
mate.
Vinky, we're looking for you, Vinky, for a put them in the gutter in one of your interviews.
100%.
We got to go. Thanks, team. See you all.
Ciao.